Please welcome Mr. Steve Angelo. We want to focus a lot on Southeast Asia, Asia Pacific. So firstly, tell me about your experiences before Swedish House Mafia, of how much time you would spend in this part of the world.
I used to come here 10 years ago. I used to play smaller club shows and do the general touring. You come in here and you do 3 to 5 shows. And then you basically go out, and you came here once a year. It was kind of the rule. Since then, you know, I think it slowed down a bit when dance music kind of kicked off into the bigger stage, because a lot of DJs wanted to go into the big stages instead of the clubs. So I think it took a while before it catched up. And now I think it's a really interesting time, you know.
You eventually got around to bringing the Swedish House Mafia show into the region. I think on that last tour, you did 4 gigs. Tell us about how you went about it and what the challenges were, because it was a different market from where the band had been concentrating.
I think the most difficult things are when you do a big tour like that is to just try and find time to get the advancing in. You know, I think when you come in and do a show, at the time we weren't present here. You know, we didn't do a lot of shows in Asia, Asian Pacific, or Japan, or, you know, we didn't come to this region at all as Swedish House Mafia. So it was kind of the first time we came in. You know, and I think the challenges there is first and foremost it's the marketing of the shows. You know, and it's been hard for us to track the Asian market because, you know, social media and stuff, you're already focused as a DJ in a lot in North America and a lot in Europe. And you never really think about a place until you know you're going there, you know. So it was something that we really wanted to do. We thought that it was an extremely important market because we have a lot of fans here. And, you know, the shows are great.
What countries did you play?
Philippines. We were here. We did Jakarta. We missed Japan. We were supposed to go to Japan. For some reason, it never happened. And I think there was a thing there as well where it's like we're not big enough or hype enough to go in and do a big arena show. So a lot of promoters don't want to take the risk.
You had you broke a lot of ground, obviously, while you were together in terms of the way you presented a show and showed what it was possible to present as 3 DJs on stage. Did you did it cost you money to come here when you did to keep that level of production up?
The thing with Swedish House Mafia,
or did you pare the show down for the market?
The thing with Swedish House Mafia was that it was never a project that we built for profit. You know, we always came in with the sense of giving something back to the fans. That was a great experience that people will talk about forever. You know, we wanted to come in and make the best show possible because we already had, you know, careers as solo artists. So when we came together, it was more like a playground where we could test and push the boundaries and we could go into places we would never go in and we could take bigger risks, financial risks as well. And I think the most important with that was that, you know, we came in to the last tour without even thinking about the finances. You know, we had to make it work, obviously. We don't want to lose money when you go on 50, 55 to 60 shows. You know, you don't want to lose money on every show because it adds up. But you actually, at least you want to come in and do the best possible thing. And you know, we brought in production and we could have brought bigger production in, but we made it work and we make a break-even show.
When you see the potential of this part of the world now and you see, I mean, in a way, you kind of excited the region when you came here. Do you got any regrets about stopping too soon?
I think this region is extremely important. You know, I always love to come here, first and foremost, for the culture and the food. You know, and I think, you know, looking at Singapore as an example, you know, it's a very interesting place in the world because the culture here has a very interesting view on behavior and how people act and how people work and crime and, you know, we have a lot to learn, you know. There's been a lot of thought behind building these countries and cities, and I've always been a big fan of the culture here. So I think first and foremost, we are excited to come here personally, because we want to enjoy it and experience it. But then I think musically, it's always been a really important part. But like I said before, social media doesn't tell the truth about the region, because a lot of fans here are not bilingual. A lot of fans here don't talk English. A lot of fans can't talk to us or communicate. So we don't see the potential here as much as we should. So I think a lot of people are afraid to come to the region and do shows. But, you know, from experience, I think this has the biggest potential in the world.
I was going to say, what would it take for an artist like yourself at your level to dedicate more time to come to China?
I mean, I think it's important as an artist to look at the region, because it's the biggest region in the world. And I saw the same potential here a couple of years ago as I did in America, 2004, 2005, 2006. So this is something that's going to grow out. It's going to outgrow America. This is going to become bigger. You know, I don't know the financials of the region right now, but I can easily see this being, you know, $1 billion, $2 billion region.
Yeah, we had the presentation at the start. So Swedish House Mafia dominated about 5 years of your life. It ended. What have you been doing for the last 18 months?
It's been a lot of work. We had a really good 2014. Record label-wise, we did really well. Worked on a lot of interesting concepts and made a lot of good, great Size in the Park shows. And we've done a lot of stuff with the Size catalog. And, you know, we launched a decade of Size this year, where we brought in Google as a partner. And we had over 600,000 people download the entire Size catalog, which is 100 releases. So we had almost 60 million downloads in a week. So we've had a lot of fun tech-wise. We had a lot of fun with the shows. You know, Size in the Park was great in May. We did a Stockholm show. It was always good to come back home. We did 70,000 people. So it's been a great year. Album work.
So tell us about the record. It seems crazy because you never actually, I don't know if people consciously aware of this, but you never made an artist album as a Swedish House Mafia, and you never made a Steve Angello album before that, so
no,
this is your debut album.
This is my debut album, my real debut album, Swedish House Mafia. We did singles, you know, and it's kind of amazing when you look at it. You know, we could tour the world and we could do stadium and arenas and festivals and we could sell millions of tickets. But we've never released an album. We did 5 singles.
You used to say to me that you made the singles to fit the show.
Yes, correct. We always looked at the shows and we felt what was missing in the show, and we always made the track specifically for that moment. So this is my first album, I would say. It's a crossover. It's dance music. It's electronic music. It's not dance music. It's an attempt to create an hybrid of all the music that I love and all the music that I've been inspired by throughout all these years, and I've kind of made them into songs. And it's different. It's really different. I'm not trying to do pop, you know. I'm not trying to. A lot of dance producers are really going towards the pop direction and the whole EDM pop clash. This is different. It's more indie, melancholic, darker. But still some big songs, but it's just different.
You've collaborated with some interesting people. I know the guy from Temper Trap has been on that first single. You've also, for a man I know as a control freak, allowed, or I wouldn't say a producer into your world, but you have collaborated with someone rather special, or you've allowed them into your world to kind of tell you whether the record's any good or not. Tell us about that.
Yeah, I'm a really good friend of Stuart Price that you know as well, really well. And I needed somebody outside of my world to coach me. I needed somebody to guide me through the musical journeys and the stops that I was given through the last 2 years. I needed somebody that I could trust well enough to tell me if I was going to the right direction. And he's been a great support and an amazing coach through this whole process, you know. And it's been really interesting because I wanted somebody that understands my space, but at the same time understands the out-of-the-box questions that I had. When I take a song and I take it too far, is it too far, or is it, could I bend it and stretch it a little more, you know? So he's been a great help.
Interestingly, for obviously being on the roll with the Swedish House Mafia, you got yourself into bed with Sony.
Yes.
For the label, but you've recently taken the record back from them. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah.
Or you bought yourself out of your deal.
I did, yes. I did a deal that I thought was great at the time. I thought it was the right move. I needed somebody with bigger distribution channels and somebody with bigger marketing channels than I had at size. But then very early on in the process, I figured out that since I am a control freak, you know, as you know, I needed creative control back. And so I bought myself back, and I have control now of the album, and it's looking better than ever.
Was there any issue of worrying about being on the same label as some of your ex-partners, or was that not a factor? Or
no, I mean, for me, the most important thing for me is that I have creative control. You know, I want to be able to be the content owner. I need to have my digital ownership. I need to have my distribution ownership, and I need to be able to navigate however I want. You know, if I wake up tomorrow morning and I say, hey, I want the whole world to get this album for free, that's what's going to happen. So I don't want anybody in the way of my decision making. And I think that was the biggest obstacle, buying my record back, because I had to go in and say, is this right? You know, I called Stuart Price 6 a.m, 5 days in a row, and I was like, fuck, am I doing this right? Or like, what is wrong? He's like, hey, stick to your gut. If you feel like this is the right move, do it. You know, and I had to.
So what are you going to do with it now? To explain how it's going to get out?
Yeah,
there?
I mean, you know, we live in a different world. You know, we live in a different world. It's different now from 10 years ago. When you release a record today, there's so many other things you can do with it. There's so many opportunities for artists. And I know a lot of artists are complaining about how it's hard to make money using streaming services, and it's hard to make money and this and that. But at the same time, you know, there's never been more opportunity in dance music than there is today. You know, every big brand in the world is interested in music. And if you're the content holder, content is king, you know. And I could easily give away an album for free, but I could actually, if you want to talk financials, I can actually make 10 times as much money on the back end. So it's just about being clever and smart with what you want to do. And, you know, we've been an indie label for such a long time, and we've been able to navigate through the digital world and the transition from analog to digital, that we're not afraid of making those steps and moves again. It's just about keeping a really tight organization.
So the album will come on size.
Album will come on size. I have a couple of majors in a couple of different territories that we use for distribution of the hard copies. But we will control and be content owners and creative control.
And would you be up for working creatively with a brand, say like Apple did?
Yeah,
with you,
I mean, I've always done that. You know, I've always done stuff like Google or bigger brands, vodka brands, and, you know, I mean, anything. You know, it depends. The only thing that's most important, I think, is that the message is very clear. You know, it's that same thing there. You got to be able to tell a story to fans that know you for who you are. I mean, I can't jump on a moped and say, hey, this is my choice that I drive when I go to the shows, just to do a marketing plot, because it's not true. You know, so I think if you're just true to what you are, there's a lot of opportunity out there, and it's probably more opportunity now than ever.
Okay. Do you think you were quite outspoken after the Swedish House Mafia about the state of dance music, of EDM?
Sure.
You said there was a lack of creativity, a lack of originality. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Sure. We grew up, as you know, if you think about the days when you used to go to the record store and you had your guy at the record store putting vinyls on the side, you know, you went there once a week and you picked up your vinyl. Every single song that I listened to had an identity. Every single producer had an identity. When you hear a Prince song, you can hear that it's Prince. When you hear Madonna sing, you can hear that it's Madonna. I can play you 200 dance songs, you wouldn't be able to tell me who it was, because people have forgot the essence of making music and creating a brand, because there's a lot of young people in dance music and there's a lot of people that doesn't understand creating your own sounds and originality, because dance music has become so easy to make, you know. And as you know, Chemical Brothers, Prodigy, Moby, Aphex Twin, Derek May, Carl Craig, I can go on and on and on. All of these guys have their identity, and that's why they're still who they are, because they created it.
It's quite ironic, really, though. I mean, you three individuals, with that Axe and Seb, as you say, you paid your dues. You're all DJs in your own right, successfully so, way before the band got together. But in many ways, you personified what one of the reasons we're in this situation, because you inspired a whole new generation.
Correct.
Who then? So you're part of the process.
I think the difference was also, like, if you look at what Swedish House Mafia did, you know, yes, we created a very strong mainstream movement, you know, but at the same time, we backed it up. You know, we delivered song after song, we delivered video after video, we delivered the tours, we delivered the shows, we delivered everything around it. So for us, you know, it was never about making money. You know, I remember, I don't want to go in deep on financials, but there was one festival where we lost $500,000 playing because we wanted to create...
I was going to ask you where all the money went.
No, because we wanted to create the best concert or festival experience we could. And we know that the benefit from that would be, the reward would be so much bigger. So we always took financial risk. So, you know, if this was about making money, I don't think Swedish House Mafia would stop touring.
Yeah. And do you think that there's far too many people in the, let's say, the EDM world then, that are in it to be famous, or in it trying to be the next Swedish House Mafia, in it for a minute as opposed to in it for the music?
Yes and no. You know, I think, you know, when it comes to promoters, it's the same thing. You know, there's those dance promoters that know what they're doing, and there's those dance promoters that don't know what they're doing. You know, and It's with anything. It's you know, when denim becomes popular, you have 2,000 brands doing denim. When sneakers became popular, there was 5,000 sneaker brands. You know, it's just a way of a product. And in the end of the day, people can say whatever they want. Music is a product in the end of the day. So it's about the passion, obviously, from the artist. But, you know, going out to consumer, you got to be clever with how you market it, because the same guys that are making really hard-hitting Dutch dance music today are the same guys that are going to make deep house tomorrow. The only difference is that they're always going to be 1 year late, because, you know, we set the trend, you know, and with Swedish House Mafia, we did our thing. We did what we believed in, and we never followed anybody's footsteps. And I think that's what's most important. It's just be original, create your own thing, and own it, you know. And I think that's the problem today. You know, I have size. I've had it for 11 years now. I get, this week I had over 1,000 demos, but I'm not going to pick up one single song, because there's nothing there that is original. And I think that's scary. It's scary to think about when you wake up tomorrow morning that, you know, who is going to be original? Who's going to create?
Do you see the proliferation of festivals and the kind of the production, the big show end of the market is in danger of kind of strangling the creativity because it's with, you know.
Yes and no.
Without there being a club scene.
Yes and no.
I mean, something we could talk about here, it's pertinent to this region, which is obviously starting to get very busy with festivals, is how important it is to have a club circuit so people can develop
of
those
course.
Ideas. And
I mean, I did a statement. Some people read it last week. I talked to Mixmag 2 weeks ago, and I said that it's really important for artists to pay their dues in the clubs. What I meant with that is that the reason why everything sounds the same is because nobody knows how to play different.
And also, you can't take so many risks if you're standing in front of 20,000 people with the pyrotechnics in a festival.
Yes, and I mean, you know, I remember, you know, you just gotta have fun with it. You know, it's easy to play safe. It's easy to just go with the flow. It's easy to just do something because the reason it works. But this has never been easy, you know. I took a risk every record I've ever done in my whole life, because it's about pushing boundaries. And it's, when I was a kid, I grew up with different mentality, because for me to even put my song on a vinyl, that record label had to invest £10,000 for it to even come out. So the filtering process was different back in the day. And as you know, you used to run a record label. Yeah. And you do it in again. And then the thing is, it's just different, you know. I love online, I love internet, it's great, you know. But at the same time, it kind of takes away from the originality, because it's so easy today. So an artist today, it does a massive announcement that they've made a new song. I've done it myself. Well, what's the big deal? Aren't you supposed to make new songs? You know, imagine if I would announce every day that I had lunch and I wouldn't eat for 5 weeks, and then I would say, hey, I'm going to have lunch today. Oh, wait, great. You know, it's just, we're supposed to make songs.
That was the start of Twitter.
We're supposed to make songs. We're supposed to release music. But at the same time, if you don't challenge yourself, what's the point? You know, we always try to make stuff bigger and better, but to make it bigger and better, we can't stop in innovation. And that's why usually I go in and I can play a festival set, and sometimes when I come off, I have DJs come up to me and they're like, how could you play that song? Because it's not commercial. How did you have the balls to play that song? But then again, you make the crowd like it, depending on your experience to play for the crowd. I deliver it in a way where I know it's going to work. You know, I don't just show up and play jazz music for everybody and be like, hey, this is great, you know?
Do you get people come up and complain if you don't play Don't You Worry, Child?
I get it every day. you can't please everybody. You can't please everybody, but you as an artist knows what works and what doesn't work, what works for you and what doesn't work for you. And usually I like to place myself in the middle of a lot of really big EDM acts, because that's how I sound different. Because a lot of people are playing the same stuff, you know, and I get reports for the record label where I can have a big release on Size, and I can get a report like, hey, this festival, they just played this song 26 times on this festival. And that's wrong to me, you know. I think you should be a little bit more original with how you play songs. And if you do play a lot of people's other songs, maybe you should edit them and do your own versions of it.
You're kind of walking the walk with your belief about you're sending a lot of your own acts out on the club circuit, aren't you?
Yeah.
That was another part of that article.
Yeah, I mean, I have to. The thing is, I have to, you know, because I don't sign acts to make money of acts. I'm signing acts because I like to develop acts, and part of the development is the training. What's the point of signing somebody that becomes big? They're big for 2 years and then they fall off. I rather give them the education they need. I'm not asking them to do something that's weird. You know, I'm just saying play more clubs. You know, and it's an important training. It's an important training. It was for me. I used to do Ministry of Sound for 8 years as a resident. You know, it was important for me. I've been doing residencies for 10, 15 years, and
We can segue into the fact that you've now just taken another one back in America, in Vegas,
yeah.
Which has obviously been the kind of epicenter in terms of EDM value in America. Tell us about the challenges of going back into Vegas and what you're trying to do there, working at a new hotel, new club, new space.
I think first and foremost, I've been coming to Vegas since 2003. It's been 11 years. I've always looked for an hotel that wants to take a risk in building a real club. You know, I've had great shows there before. It's been a lot of fun. But I went to Life at the SLS because, first and foremost, it reminds me most of a club. You know, and the sound system is great. The potential there is amazing. You know, and you look at the lineups that they do. You have a show there, and they are taking risks. And taking risks today in dance music is not nice. To book pop artists. Yeah. That's taking a risk in dance music terms today, which is weird. But they're taking risks with booking people that don't only play top 40. And it's been a challenge, obviously. You know, they're a new hotel, new organization. They've never worked on that scale before. But, you know, I have a great team that works 24/7 to make it amazing and to make it as good as we can. And it gives me a freedom. It gives me freedom to play whatever I want because I have the backup of the sound system. I have a backup of a great clubbing atmosphere. So I can do whatever I want in that room, and I know it's going to work. And I think that was the key. I want to find a place where I can call home and then find a place that I'm willing to put in the risk.
Other thing, a couple of, let's break away from, we'll change the subject a little bit and talk about radio. You obviously I've known you for a long time. You've always been passionate about what I've been doing on the radio, but you stepped up and got the opportunity to do your own show on Radio 1, which you've been doing for a year. I believe the residency's just finished.
Yes.
So how was that?
It was amazing. I love radio. I love being able. What it did for me was it gave me an opportunity once a month to dig deep and really listen through the whole spectrum of music. And the show is very diverse.
It wasn't ghosted by anybody. You were sitting up in the middle of the night and you.
Yeah, I mean most of the guys don't do their own shows, you know. And I had to I need that control again. I'm a OCD, but. I had to do it, and I thought it was fun. It took me almost a week to go through music for each show. That was the best week, digging in and going deep and premiering people's songs and playing stuff that I wouldn't play on the festival, playing stuff that I would just wanted to introduce to the world and really show that it's stuff that I liked. And it was amazing. It was a huge social media event every time I played. You know, we have almost 60 to 70,000 tweets every show, Facebook and Instagram and all those. It went really well. The engagement and interaction was great. So I had my last show last week, and I already miss it.
Well, hopefully you'll do it again sometime in the not too distant future. Outside of music, you're quite active. I've been reading about your investments in other businesses. Do you want to touch on that a little bit? I know you've got a vodka.
I do. I
think you've
vodka.
Got a biofuel as well.
I sold biofuel. Right. I sold it.
This is not dung. manure.
No, that was the biofuel was something that I invested in early, mid 2000. It was a great opportunity. You know, you produce biofuel. Green biofuel, and the production of the plant is 5 steps, and I did my exit on the 4th step. So, and then there's a lot of other stuff: tech companies, headphone companies, real estate, hotels, ski resorts.
So, if anyone wants to start a new business, here's your man.
That's a good idea. A lot of stuff. I have a creative agency, advertising agency. You know, obviously, record label and everything else is great. You know, so it's a lot of work.
I thought I was busy.
I don't
sleep.
I had 3 hours tonight. So,
That's mad. And coming back to the label, tell us about Size and Size X.
X is more of a housey, techy kind of thing, you know. As you know, and a lot of people know, I like to go play after parties, and I like to after hours for many, many hours. And X caters to that. Size is going really well. This year, we're going to see a really big expansion this year, where we took back creative control of everything from my album to everything else, and we're just really working on the distribution platform for the hard copies. And then we're gonna have a big year next year. We're really widening the label with artist signings and ways we're moving it. And the events, Size in the Park next year is gonna be in 10 cities.
Did you do Art Basel again this year?
No, I was supposed to, but right. I actually did my last Radio 1 show last week, so yeah. I missed. I always want to go to Art Basel, but I'm thinking I'll save my energy for Miami Music Week.
You thought about bringing one of those parties to this part of the world?
Yes. Yeah, we're talking about doing Size in a Park, which is we have 6 places in North America. We have 4 places in Europe. And then we're thinking about India. We're also talking about Tokyo. And I want to look into Singapore, Jakarta.
Okay. Conscious of time here, maybe we'll open up to some questions from the floor now. It's a rare opportunity to ask Steve Angello anything you like.
or tweet me. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah. In residency, you've always emphasized that you want to dig deep and basically play music for people so that they discover other kinds of music as well and correct. They pick up on it. While you are in the studio and you're making music, do you care about whether this is going to be picked up by another DJ to play out, or is it just about expressing yourself?
No, I think I'm at a stage in life where I have nothing to prove. I've worked really hard for so many years that, you know, I want to cater myself. I want to feel great about the music I make, and I rather take a little bit of risk in doing something that doesn't fit in what the music sounds like today, but hopefully it sounds like in a year. So I rather take that risk, and like I did on the Radio 1 show, it's very wide, you know, and with the Radio 1 show, I kind of wanted to educate my fan base to be a little bit more open-minded in what's to come. So it was basically a preparation for the album.
If there was one thing you could change about the EDM industry right now, what would it be?
Oof. I think we should pause everything for a second and just rethink. I think everybody needs a thinker, a little break, and then I would love to see some crazy stuff happen in the next 2 years, but we'll see. I think we need to think more, and we need to talk more to people around us about the future plans. I think that's really important.
Meditate,
yes.
Hi, I'm Sabrina. Hi. I DJ in Singapore, and the last time I tried to see you, I kind of missed it because I got a bit too hammered in Ibiza. That was in Pacha, two years ago.
Yeah.
So my question for you is, as a DJ, looking at the music industry as a whole, what do you foresee the future trends to be, and how do you feel you can influence the trends, if any?
I think, you know, we're at the point now with dance music where it has become very mainstream. You know, I've been part of it myself, and you can also blame me for a small part of it. But I think that what's going to happen is, you know, a lot of dance artists are moving into the pop spectrum. And then I think it's going to filter out. I think a lot of music is going to filter. I see a lot of more people going towards the roots. I think dance music is starting to... The fans that were up on the surface on the mainstream, the fans that are really into the music scene has dug deeper and figured out what the subcultures are. And I think slowly but surely, more people are going to realize and get accustomed to what dance music is all about. And I think, you know, to change that, we can just hope for being innovative and try. You know, I can't... You can never say that you're going to do something 100%, but I would like to at least contribute to it.
Do you think that's... I mean, that's happened quite successfully in the UK in the last few years. Do you see that happening in America now?
I see that slowly, but I've always seen UK and Germany and Holland, you know, Japan. I've always seen them as... The places where the subcultures come through, and especially looking at the UK. UK was such an important part for us when we grew up, and it formed dance music, my world of dance music. And I think it's really important to realize that those subcultures are what's going to create the scene. And we just got to dig deeper, I guess, and you know, just try and be open-minded and try to see things differently. And
Avicii was pretty smart in collaborating with Chinese artists and in terms of getting the message out there. Would you consider doing that, collaborating with artists from?
I mean, it depends. Yeah. You know, I think it's if you're reaching for success, and you want to become, you know, a really big pop artist, I think that's a great choice. You know. I don't have those ambitions. So for me, it's about if it's a really cool Chinese artist that I think does great music, yeah, of course. But it's not, in the end of the day, I don't understand Chinese, you know? I don't speak Mandarin, I don't speak the languages, I don't speak Japanese, I don't speak... So it's hard for me to collaborate with an artist that I don't understand. So from a business point of view, that's a great choice for him, but I wouldn't do that unless I could understand the music.
Okay.
I wanted to understand a bit more about Reflections. Is it a residency exclusive to SLS? Is it a brand that you want to build out? What's the concept?
It's my concept. I own it. It's exclusive to SLS Life now, but it's something that will be built out. The show will be built out throughout the year as well. We're adding a lot of crazy stuff to the show, and you know, working with technology from NASA, working with a lot of developers into creating something that's really different and mind-blowing. And there's a lot of technology that goes into the show, and we've had these great 360 sound captures and 360 visual captures, and there's a lot of stuff that are coming that I can't touch on now, but next year is going to be really interesting development-wise.
That's one of the really good things about Vegas, that you can experiment with that stuff because they've kind of got the capabilities to do it.
Yes.
Another question?
That's it? One more here.
One more, come on.
Are you sick of people trying to create a beef between you and your former...
Members?
Yeah.
No, I mean, listen. People don't understand what music making is all about. We didn't start making music because we were fighting, you know. I'm not competing with anybody. I'm doing my own thing. But people don't understand that, so they will obviously tweet stuff or, you know, they have a different approach than me. It's great. You know, I'll always love them like brothers. You know, I really don't ever care what people say online. You know, I used to brush that off 10 years ago. If I would care, I wouldn't be doing music today. I would probably sit at home miserable. So I think it's part of your growth as an artist, and you just got to grow thick skin and not care.
How big would the check have to be to get you back together? You said I could ask you anything.
I've said no to the biggest check I've ever seen.
Okay.
So nothing.
Bigger than that.
No, listen. We had a great chapter. Don't get me wrong. You know, we did some amazing stuff together. It was a fun project. We came together and we had some amazing shows. We did some great music and we had great success with it. You know, sometimes stuff aren't meant to be working. You know, it's like a relationship. You know, if you ask two parents that are divorcing why they're divorcing, it's just not working out, and it's. If it was that easy, you know, we have emotions and feelings, and
so
it's pretty straightforward. It's not working.
That's good. That's what Fleetwood Mac said.
Yeah, listen.
They just got back together.
If my life goes down the drain, and we get a tour offer in 50 years, and I'm an old man.
I was going to say, exactly.
I'm an old man, and I'm like, hey.
It was it was Sandy from Universal. I had a great film up here earlier of the old people's home raving to Don't You Worry Child, actually.
Yeah.
Steve, thank you. Fantastic spending time with you, and I'm sure everyone enjoyed it.
Thank you
very much.